Good afternoon, good evening, and good morning. My name is Leonard Lee, and I am the founder and managing director of NextCurve, and we are a research advisory firm based in San Diego that focuses on exploring and charting the frontier markets forming at the intersect of transformative technologies such as cloud, AI, 5G, IoT, and much more. I will be talking about the vision and hopes for autonomous technologies for vehicles and transportation at large. And I'd like to see if I can frame the purpose that'll make this autonomous transformation of driving and transportation one worth pursuing. In other words, getting beyond the technology for technology's sake. So let's start off with the vision of autonomous vehicles. What would a world look like if the majority, if not all, vehicles on the road were autonomous? Well, for one, none of us would ever have to drive again. And this is an idea that my German friends don't take kindly to. I don't know about yours. But in this case, will we ever need to own a car? After all, if cars can drive themselves and we can consume mobility as a service, why take on the significant cost of owning a car? Think about it. The cost of the car, insurance, maintenance, registration, gas costs, and for most of us, the car sits in the garage or in a parking lot 90% of the time, if not more. And speaking of parking lots, will we ever need parking lots again? Maybe we'll just need charging lots for all the shared autonomous vehicles that would return there to get some juice between service outings. And we could repurpose all that land and we could reduce our urban footprint in the process. And all of this looks and sounds great, but why will it matter? What do we hope to achieve by realizing this driverless utopia? And the question we should be asking ourselves is, what do the benefits of a driverless future look like? Well, here are a few of the value propositions that have become the mainstream staples. First, traffic efficiency. For the individual, this means getting to places faster. I mean, it's simple as that. At a more macro level, this means reducing the traffic congestion that contributes to around $87 billion in economic loss in the United States every year. Second is safety. And the hope is that autonomous vehicles at some point will reduce the 35,000 some odd deaths a year in the US, according to the NHTSA. And hopefully, it will help bite into the 1.3 5 million who die on the road globally, according to the WHO. And that's on a yearly basis. Next, we have economic and societal harm. And by reducing the number of accidents, which are over 6 million in the US and millions more around the world, we're hoping that self-driving cars will reduce the trillion-ish dollars in economic and societal harm that are incurred in the US every year in the form of lost productivity, property loss, injury, and disability. This is according to a revised study of the economic and societal impact of motor vehicle crashes in 2015 by the National Highway Traffic Safety Association, or NHTSA, that I mentioned prior. And imagine the benefits that can be realized at a global level. Now, finally, sustainability and the environment. The final hope that I will list here is that the reduced parking lot acreage, the reduced traffic congestion that self-driving vehicles will foster will reduce air and noise pollutions and contribute to the reduction of the urban heat island effect that metropolitan areas such as Los Angeles suffers. These all sound like noble causes and titanic value propositions that make self-driving cars kind of look like no-brainers, right? However, there are a number of challenges that we must overcome to realize the benefits of a driverless and autonomous future. Now, last month at the first inaugural IAA mobility event in Munich, I watched a mind-blowing presentation by Professor Philippe Rode of LSE Cities. In his presentation, he stated that the autonomous car would not materially improve traffic on the roads in our cities. And he put up this sobering picture that put the autonomous car into perspective as a highly likely non-solution for our traffic ailments. Even if most autonomous vehicles on the road become or vehicles on the road become autonomous, there is only so much more utilization you get out of shared assets than what you get out of one that is human operated. And we do need to consider the reimagining of our cities in conjunction with a more distilled understanding of the value of autonomous vehicles. In some countries, rules of the road are for braking or disregard. One of the things that comes up all too often in conversations about self-driving AI is the not so far-fetched quip that the company that can figure out autonomous driving for India basically wins. And it's not just me. I have heard executives bring this up in their keynotes time and time again. And now, how do you predict the behavior of a cow or drivers on the road who have no sense of structure or rules in their driving behavior? Our autonomous driving systems today might just decide, hey, forget this, I'm not moving. Too risky, too many crazy human drivers. Get out and take a bus, right? While India might be an extreme case, the diversity of driving cultures will pose a challenge for the industry. Can you sell an autonomous vehicle fluent in driving in the US in India? How do you develop an AI to predict events that arise out of bad or irrational driving, road rage, distracted driving, all these things that we'll have to suffer on the roads for the years and, let's be honest, decades to come? There are only a few ways, if not only one way, of doing things smart and by the book. That's easier to codify and train in an AI model. There are infinite permutations of nonsensical things that people and animals do with potential dire consequences on the road. The most important challenge the autonomous vehicle utopia faces, however, is scaling the hypothetical benefits of autonomy through the vehicle. The fact is, according to IDC's 2018 forecast for ADAS, vehicles with level zero automation will continue to dominate the share of vehicles produced until 2024. In 2018, IHS Market ambitiously forecasted that autonomous vehicle sales would surpass 33 million units annually in 2040. But that would constitute only 26% of new car sales. And of course, you have to take forecasts that go out 20 years with a grain of salt, but without some significant catalyst, our vision and hopes for a driverless utopia are quite a ways off. And we need to be mindful, because we risk constraining ourselves of the broad benefits of autonomous transportation systems with an overweighted focus on achieving a certain critical mass of autonomous vehicles on the road. And until we hit this inflection point, it's just a few self-driving vehicles in the midst of human whim and imperfection. So, what is it that we can do to accelerate and broaden the benefit of automation and autonomic systems across our transportation system? How do we overcome these aforementioned structural and mindset obstacles that stand in the way of realizing early and broad benefit? And one approach would be to look at the solution and its evolution over time from a system of systems perspective. What do I mean by this? Well, you know, let's start with the vehicle, since we're talking about autonomous cars. We are all familiar, I think, with the SAE, or the Society of Automotive Engineers, levels of vehicular automation. And I think it's important to understand that the five levels are not levels of autonomy, rather automation. Only levels 3 through 5 represent some degree of autonomous driving capability. And as I mentioned earlier, We will be dealing with level 0 through 2 vehicles, animals, and animal-driven cars for quite some time. ADAS systems, however, that can provide human operators with digitally augmented support is where the low-hanging fruit lies, and the automation level that we will see increase in absolute terms in the global vehicle install base for the next decade, at least. And next, we should consider the digital maturity of transport infrastructure, our roads, our highways, our intersections, signage, traffic signals. I like to look at this from the perspective of IoT, where as we mature our capabilities, we're able to realize a contextual computing infrastructure that merges the physical with the digital. And the reason why I think this is such an important lever for expanding intelligent and autonomous benefits is that intelligent infrastructure is a great way of engaging digitally immature or deficient vehicles and things and getting them integrated into the intelligent transportation system, either actively or passively through means such as object to detection at an intersection with a computer vision and a camera. And while there are reference architecture depictions of an intelligent transportation system or ITS, it seems that there's an absence of a capability maturity model. And here's one that I've proposed and used in my discussions regarding the future of transportation. Now, the third element that we need to talk about is connectivity, in particular, mobile wireless. And why does this matter? Regardless of how smart we believe the vehicle will get, there will be value in their communicating with each other and with their surroundings, whether it's the infrastructure, services, or pedestrians. And this is not to say that the autonomous vehicles will depend on 5G, but opportunities to realize shared benefit through novel services and architectures can emerge as we evolve intelligent transportation systems over time. The 5GAA or 5G Automotive Association is working really closely with the 3GPP to drive the requirements of the automotive and transportation industries in shaping the future of CV2X or cellular vehicle to everything communications. Their roadmap will be important to consider as we ideate, plan, develop, and deploy the intelligent transportation systems of today and the future. And ultimately, we need to think about these three system elements holistically as we evolve automation, digitalization, and progress toward autonomous functions and capabilities that will help us achieve our aspirations for a self-driving utopia. The self-driving vehicle is still a moonshot. It really is. I have to agree with my German buddies. I like to drive, and I don't find myself jonesing for self-driving capabilities. Driver assist? Yes. Some automation here and there? Definitely yes. Very nice. But in order to scale out the benefits of autonomous technologies on our roads, we'll need to think more holistically about the solutions that we build and deploy with digital automation, IoT, sensors, actuators, controls, AI, and autonomic systems. Technology does not solve problems. They enable the applications that do. The trick will be solving the easiest problems with the broadest impact and societal and economic benefit while continuing to invest in and develop the solutions to the most difficult problems that drive the leading edge of what we can do. And if you'd like to find out more about NextCurve's research on the future of transportation, check out my research brief on the future of transportation, a system of systems perspective on the future of the car. It's available on the NextCurve research blog at www.next-curve.com. Thanks to the Fierce Electronics team for inviting me to speak and present on this exciting topic. I hope that you enjoy the rest of this program and the Autonomous Technologies Summit 2021. Thank you.